My name is Dave Hawley. I'm the principal scientist at Fluence, and today we're here at Texas Original, the leading cannabis producer in all of Texas. Together, Fluence and Texas Original do some of the world's leading photobiology research on the effects of light quality on cannabis production. Today we're here to talk about photobleaching. Photobleaching is essentially the destruction of chlorophyll at the top of your canopy. It takes those upper inflorescences or buds that should hold the highest market value, and it turns them white, basically destroying any value they might have on the store shelf. We're going to talk about what you can do with lighting to make sure this doesn't happen to you, to keep those buds green, and ultimately maximize your bottom line. We all know a little bit about chlorophyll. We know that it's what makes plants look green. But really, when we see plants as green, what's happening with that pigment is that it's absorbing all of the red and blue photons. If we destroy that compound that's absorbing red and blue light and reflecting green, then we end up with something that just looks white. If you still have incoming light energy from the sun or from supplemental lighting, you're still adding energy to the system even though it has nowhere to go. And when chlorophyll is trying to manage all of that energy, it can handle it to a point. But eventually you get something called quantum state shift. And chlorophyll changes its quantum state in a way that makes it very reactive with oxygen. And if we have this energetic chlorophyll that now becomes very reactive with oxygen, oxygen is going to gobble up all those free electrons and chlorophyll just falls apart. What's even worse than that is oxygen now has so much energy that it becomes even more reactive with all the other molecules around it. This is what you hear about when people say reactive oxygen species and the need for antioxidants in plants and in animals. If you don't have a way of dealing with this excess energy or transferring this energy somewhere new, you will have chlorophyll destruction and ultimately you end up with photobleaching.
So what we're looking at in this room is the effect of light intensity and light spectrum in a gradient. We've got a high intensity, 1500 micromoles, going to a lower intensity, 900 micromoles. And then from going from the front of the room to the back of the room, we're decreasing our red light percentage. So at the front, we've got around 80% red. And as we get to the back, we get to about 40% red. So as we integrate the gradients of light intensity and red percentage, we get a gradient across the room of absolute number of red photons, which is what leads to that photobleaching. So this experiment's a little bit different than how we normally set up experiments. In this room, each plant is an individual treatment. So I'll go through with a spectrometer and measure at each plant the intensity, the red light percentage, and the total number of red photons. And we'll be able to add a photobleaching metric in terms of incidence and severity at each plant to understand exactly what lighting conditions lead to incidence and severity of photobleaching. So we've seen that with increasing total red photons, we're seeing increased photobleaching. So what we see here is a premium example of photobleaching. This plant would have developed in the most high red portion of the room where we're at 1500 micromoles and about 80% red. And so in a pretty severe case like this, we're not just seeing photobleaching just the tip, we're also seeing it pretty far down the inflorescence. Depending on the cultivar, the way that photobleaching manifests, it can look differently, and that really depends on what the bud structure of the specific cultivar looks like. So even though it's a very striking visual difference, we don't necessarily see that photobleaching affects potency. As we increase our intensity, we can increase our yield and potency in some cases, having the maximum return for the grower. We've got a range of different cultivars in this room to understand the genetic underpinnings to what causes a plant to be susceptible to photobleaching. For growers growing for a premium flower market, understanding which cultivars are most sensitive to photobleaching can make sure that they're not growing those cultivars and running the risk of photobleaching on their premium product. For a grower growing for extract, the highest amount of red light has the lowest operating cost, and if it doesn't matter what the visual appearance of the bud looks like, they can grow under a high red environment. Fluence is able to take the results from this research and use it in two ways. One, it helps us inform product development, so we can understand exactly what red light percentages at what intensity are going to lead to photobleaching. We can develop a new fixture with a different spectrum so that when we run it at a high intensity, growers aren't running the risk of photobleaching their crop. The second thing we can use these results for is to understand exactly for growers what lighting recommendations we want to make with our current offering, to understand what intensity we can run a certain spectrum at and not see the effects of photobleaching.
research that we do here at Texas Original with Fluence really helps us drive towards higher yields and just better overall quality of medicine for our patients. The beauty here of us being able to run production alongside with R&D is that the R&D, at the end of the day, it drives our production. What we learn from the R&D trials that we do here ultimately feeds into our production rooms and our production model. It's like a beautiful partnership of research and production go hand in hand to feed each other. I believe that the research that we do changes the way cannabis is grown in the world. Whether that's through high light intensity or spectrum, it's this research that we do here today that ultimately helps drive how production happens tomorrow.